Oh yeah, tape machine. Short introduction, I'm Crisp, I guess most of you know me. I run Wir machen bunt and I patch since 2004. This is my colleague Gloria. Most of you might know her as well. She works for Wir machen bunt or at Wir machen bunt, I think 3 years now, or two? Two?
1.5.
1.5? Okay, it's just so short, it feels longer. I just skipped that because I just asked. And now the question, what is a state machine? Wikipedia says it's a mathematical computational model. I've been, when you research on Wikipedia, they are like they mention a number of different machines, and the state machine is basically, or a finite state machine is basically the most simplest form of a definable algorithm that sort of like allows you to make decisions in the end. There are some more complex machines, like for you might know the Turing machine. So there's like gradually increasing complexity in terms of machines, but we only work with a finite state machine today. That is actually what a finite state machine means. It is actually a machine which has like a finite number of states. That's about it. In terms of terminology, I use some words today, basically not many. A state is basically represents the state of the software. Could be a menu, could be a game mode, could be a high score, could be whatever. Playing a video, that's a state. Everything in between these states is a transition. And one could distinguish also between like the transitions and actions. Basically, an action is something which triggers a transition, although in the editor I'm showing it's basically the same. Transition is an action. I found this funny Wikipedia example, which is a turnstile, and it's somehow shows this we are very, very simple state machine. You only have two states which say this turnstile can be locked or it can be unlocked. And there are only two actions, hence transitions, which can change these states. So while you are in the lock mode and you can't go through, you can put in a coin, and the coin moves to the state, or basically the turnstile moves to the state unlocked. And from here you have the ability, okay, you can put in the coin as well, but nothing happens basically until you go back to the same state. Or you push the turnstile and you go back to lock. That's pretty much a very, very simple state machine, which I find quite easy to understand. And this kind of graphical representation is quite common in terms of state machines, which I'm gonna show later. What can you do with a state machine? You can control the behavior of your software, of course. Why are we doing it anyway? Basically, to avoid bugs, primarily, or basically, that's why I use a state machine, to don't get into this kind of frame delay, monoflop, switch warp, switch hell, which is like really prone to get bugs basically. It provides an overview abstraction of your software flow. Yeah, it makes you aware of how actually your software looks like. Usually, when you start patching, you have some sort of like abstract image of your application in your head, but you never really see that in terms of like flow. And a graphical state machine basically shows it. Yeah, it's easy to allows easy debugging because in terms of a graphical state machine, when you see basically the state machine says, yeah, we are in this state, and you watch your renderer and it's not matching, so it's easier to find like in the errors basically. You always like compare, okay, I'm in state, and in this state I expect this kind of behavior, and if it's not happening, so it's quite easy to find or look for the place in your patch to fix that error. This is quite optional. Yeah, demonstrate your software by jumping to stage. This is pretty much specific concerning Automata UI, because the UI allows you to force states and transitions. We can jump inside your software, which is quite convenient. I mean, we're using this when we have like complex VVV presentation with a lot of scenes and stuff, and the customer comes to us and wants to see like a specific part of the software. It's really easy, like to use your Automata editor and just control click the state and you jump to that scene and you can talk about it. It's much easier than going through that whole interaction story, basically, when you basically follow the whole interaction story. Yeah, I've showed that at the keynote. This is basically a prime example of patching without a state machine. It's just a simple video player. You can play, pause, scrub. It's quite funny. Basically, everyone I ask, like, when you're doing this kind of stuff, like built around the UI, around the file stream node, you always end up with stuff like that. It gets ugly, basically. It doesn't really tell you, is it actually playing now? You have to put some I/O boxes inside. When you want like some neat transitions, like fading in, fading out, it's quite complicated. Especially that part, the scrub interface, it's quite tricky because it's an interface element and it's at the same time it's a display. While you're playing, it shows you the progress in the video, and when you touch it, it's actually an interface element, and you have to distinguish between these kind of states basically, and then this is basically the point where a state machine comes in. I'm not going to say who patched that. Yeah, I've marked some bits and pieces. That's the typical mayhem: monoflop, talk edge, flip flop, decay, plus, with another decay. It's like, yeah, something you don't want to do. So of course there was a solution before. Who actually worked with the old Automata? Nobody. Never ever. Okay, I've met some people who worked with it. I worked with it before, but not in that way. Like when you had to define these kind of quadruples to define your logic tree, which I find like really, I don't know. I think I've understood it once and then I just forgot about it and never learned it again, because I find it like really counterintuitive. It's ugly by definition, yeah, of course. But actually it made me aware of that there are state machines. I didn't know there are any before, so this note was quite an introduction to the concept at all. I've used for a long time this kind of editor, and which looks pretty similar to Automata UI. It's QFSM, it's like an external program which you can use to define your state machine trees. You have your states, you have your transitions, it's pretty much the same, and then you basically press file, export, you get your VVV quadruples, you import it into VVV, and you've got your state machine set up. But it's, to some extent, it's not really, it is kind of convenient if you don't have anything else, but it's kind of, yeah, it's not convenient in that way, basically, because you have always to use these kind of external program, and every change in your logic flow means you have to go back to the program at a state, copy the quadruples, go back into VVV, and then there's like this kind of major bug in Automata, in the old Automata node, basically, if you change quadruples, it breaks the node. So you have to delete the node, create a new one again, copy your new quadruples in, and then you have to make all the connections again, which is like really, really painful. Some guy told me last note, which is quite funny, he found a workflow. Basically, when he updates his quadruple code in the old Automata node, he was like doing it that way, that he actually copy-pasted into the node. Okay, it breaks the node. Then he was deleting it. And then he pressed the control Z.
Yeah.
this is the nice VVV workflow I like. But on the other hand, basically, as I said, it's not really convenient and it's missing actually some nice features. Basically, it's not an obvious display of your software structure because it's not integrated, the visual part is not integrated into VVV. So then I thought maybe I could do my own thing. And it was basically my first bigger, larger C-sharp project, and yeah, it was quite a ride, to be honest. But I learned a lot. I'm probably not going into details so much in terms of the interface. We just start up the patch or the node itself, and then I go through the interaction and explain it there. Any questions in the meantime?
Where can you get the workshop?
Oh, it's on the server. Or you can have a stick. Okay, I'm starting up some random. Help patch. Just quickly go through the interface, which I guess is not much to tell about, but let's do it anyway. So basically, what you create is like only two things. You can create states and you can create transitions. States are created by double click, and you get this context menu where you can type in a name for the state and a frame count. The frame count is pretty specific. It allows you to define a duration for a locked state. So when you type in like 60, then you can and you reach that reach that kind of state, it's always locked for at least 60 seconds. Can be convenient for some cases. But I usually leave that at zero. So let's press OK. creating transitions is done by right click, starting a transition, left click, closing a transition. So right click and you've got the cable, left click and it closes the connection, and you can give this transition a name as well and a duration. Here, in this case, the duration is meant for animation purposes. So you can basically define how long a fade, for example, runs between two states. Any idea what ping pong means? What it could be used for?
To go back to the in this case, to the state before.
Yeah, okay. It's basically like a two-directional transition, which can be triggered by the same bang later on. So there's a distinction actually between this kind. This is the standard transition, which has only one direction. Or in some cases, but in very rare cases, you need a transition which is like two-directional, which can go ding, 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 this kind, doing this kind of stuff. My dear friend Bo27 from Russia asked for Bezier transitions in the forum, so yeah, you can do that as well. Oh, come on. Go mouse click. Am I having the wrong VVV? Yeah, I've got an old automata version here. Fuck. Damn. So it looks like I've copied the wrong version into the workshop folder. Yeah, it's in the most recent one, switch topic, but I think the video player is the most recent one. Plugins. Let's get VVV. It's not much difference basically between the versions. The only difference is actually the Bezier transitions. So right click and you get these kind of stuff. Which might come handy at some point, but I actually prefer these kind of straight lines because you get like more structured look. I don't know. Is this working for you?
The first thing we do is Roshadi to add a
language. So if I drag the automata UI DLL to the patch,
you get
this red. I get the three options and I chose the automata UI.
Yeah, it's red because you don't have a state yet. Or a second a state to go yet. So yeah, basically when you start up the plugin, you usually start with this kind of init state, which is basically the source of all evil. This kind of interaction, which might probably feel funny, like this doing a transition by right click, left click. I didn't came up with that. It's basically I showed the editor to some people, and I've seen it like a lot of time that people are actually trying to do the transition that way, for some reason I don't know. So I just adopted it.
How to call the Bezier
function? Right click on the transition. Which version do you have?
I took the one from.
You can just download it from the VVV website.
The video player.
It's referenziert, wenn du eine andere Version da irgendwie reingezogen hast.
Okay.
Ja, du hast immer noch die falsche Version, im Prinzip, weil die Docking auf dem Boot ist.
Okay, ja. Dann
machen wir richtig aus.
Aus.
Ich hab die gerade aus dem Videoplayer gemacht.
Okay. Hab dich irgendwie auch. Ich kann beide wahrscheinlich nichts referenzieren, weil ihr nicht.
Something else I've already forgot is basically you can move the stage by just right click, running, into the black and just move your with the right mouse button and just move the stage. There's no zooming. I'm sorry. There probably never will be because I don't need it for myself. So I don't know. Never do this kind of like crazy automata trees. Because I guess if you get to that stage, if you have this crazy automata stage, it's probably a something you probably made something wrong, because you put too much stuff in the state machine in terms of information, or it's maybe time to split the state machine in separate state machines and modular wise. So for me, it's best practice to actually have like a logic tree which somehow fits into that frame. Very rarely that you need more than that. Has anyone found out how to delete a state or a transition?
Middle mouse,
yeah. So.
Is it possible to go from a state and state while
doing a transition?
You know what I mean? So if I right click on my state and I click,
do I first have to create a new state? Yeah. Okay, and then I can do the transition. Yeah, exactly.
So I can't do the transition and.
But where is the transition leading to? And if you don't have a target?
Maybe I have it in the head already.
It's the way, basically, for a transition you need two states,
yeah,
basically.
Yeah.
It's basically the same, middle mouse click on the transition name. And I can actually improve that kind of UI behavior because for the Bezier curves, I just recently implemented like hit detection for lines. So I could actually do deleting and editing transitions by double clicking or middle clicking on the line as well. Right now it just only works on the name itself. But I can improve that. Has anyone seen the state machine from Vux yesterday? Some of you. It's basically Vux sent me that as a VVE plugin like 1.5 years ago, and I thought, okay, well, my state machine problems are solved. I don't have to do it myself. But his state machine has some. Might have to do because it's coming from Fairtech, because Fairtech some works to some extent a little bit different. But I couldn't really use the state machine. It was working in a weird way, and I think in terms of visuals, it wasn't quite right working with these kind of boxes, because like a state is always like for me a circular thing. It can be approached from different angles. So I decided to. I found the QFSM way of displaying the state machine like pretty convincing. So I did it basically the same. Okay, that's pretty much in terms of creation and deletion. What you can do is basically you can force states and transitions already by control click. Okay, in terms of the transition, doesn't really make sense right now because my transitions are just one frame long, so I won't see it. Let's make this transition a little bit longer. Let's say 120 frames, then you see it for 2 seconds.
Is there a way to undo stuff?
No. I just follow the transition of timeliner. No undo. But I wonder if you really do need that, because you can't do that much in that. It's not a timeline. It's just so simple actually that anything you do can't be that destructible.
They have a lot of connections, and they accidentally little mouse click on the central stage.
But that's basically the reason why I put delete on the middle mouse click, because you hardly use that. It's pretty far away. You have to really think about it and do it. It's just not happening by accident, I guess. Or are you using middle mouse click on any other application?
No. That's silly. I did it a lot of times when I was trying to use it.
But of course, yeah, you can make like this is something which is like probably hurting a lot if you have stuff like that. And you just delete this state.
Yeah.
That's painful. I think about it. Okay. So we learned about creation, deletion, and forcing transitions and states. What actually happens is, or what you would expect, is when you create a transition, you would expect that this also creates an input pin to actually trigger this transition. So in this case, let's rename this go go go. So I would expect that I have a pin which is called go go go. Yes, we have. Let's zoom in a little bit. So you see this transition is basically turning up as an input pin here. So this actually allows me to trigger this transition. And it's working. I have a second transition, my transition. There's a pin as well, my transition. And I could trigger this, and I would go from this state to this state. Okay, question. I'm in this state. And I trigger go go go. What is gonna happen?
Nothing.
Nothing, exactly. Because there is no route. Go 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 is like one directional, it just leads to this kind of state. And so that is basically what makes a state machine really good, because it makes decisions for you. It only allows certain routes you have to define. And that makes it really simple and really powerful. I've copied basically the behavior of the old automata node. Basically, if you have transitions with the same name, they only turn up as one pin. So let's say I do another transition from here to here and call it again go go go. No second go 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 pin turns up. I just have one. Okay, this probably goes pretty stupid what I'm doing here. Like I have two similar named transitions. If you do this kind of stuff, it doesn't break the state machine. It just chooses the first one. Let's try that. Or let's say typical example, if you want to do a presentation consisting of different slides and you want to use the state machine to basically control your presentation in very, very simple ways, you do something like that. Call this transition, for example, next. This one, next. Let's say this state is called char1. This state is called video. And the last one is called thank you, whatever. And by naming all transitions next, this would allow you to actually skip through your presentation in an easy way. So let's start here. Let's give everything a transition time. Let's say 60 frames. And let's go next, next, next. Pretty simple. Or if you are really crazy, you could do a backward transition. Let's do that for the first time and then call this previous. So now you have a simple control for your presentation. Next, previous. So how would you handle the states in your patch? That would be the next question. So now we have the state machine to some extent, and how would you handle basically ask in which state are we right now to basically toggle your graphics or control your sublogic. For this purpose I made a convenience node which is called get state. When you drag drop the automata UI DLL into your patch, you get to choose between three nodes. The automata itself, and here you have the node get state. So if get state is red, nothing is wrong, and get state just doesn't know about the state machine yet. And you have to connect the automata UI node with get state by the most right output pin, which basically outputs the whole state machine. So do it like that, basically. Yeah, exactly.
Oh.
Sorry about that. Get state, you have to locate your automata DLL in the workshop folder and just drag drop in. I'm not really sure if I should make a pack out of it, but maybe it's convenient, more convenient, but it's just a node, it's not really a pack. So once you connected get state to the state machine, it's not red anymore, and it actually knows about all the states already. So you have a anom pin at the top, and you can choose whatever state you are asking for. So let's say I'm asking here for charge 01. And it gives me the information if this is this state active. So I can use this actually to toggle some drawing, some quads or whatever, on and off, some graphics. What's really convenient is are these two states basically, or these two outputs. I've got fade in and out and fade direction. So in case you gave your transition a time, it actually shows you the fade in to the state and the fade out from the state. So in case, let's go to init and say, let's make a slider out of it to show it a little bit better. Okay, we are in an init state and we are going from init to chart one. And I would expect that get state asking for chart one is actually giving me the fade into that state. So let's try that. Next. And it actually was fading in. Show that again. Next. And in case I'm going from chart one to video, for example, I would expect the fade out. So let's say next, fade out.
Is there a way to set the transition time by pin or by the VDDV externally?
Not yet. I mean, we can discuss it if you want that. I didn't need it so far because I mean, always have this kind of UI open and I set the times there. It's just basically a matter if you want to have like changing times, dynamic times, then it would make sense. Yeah.
This would be a great feature. I'm trying to make a queue system.
Mm-hmm.
So where you program your fade times. This would be just the way to go.
Okay. Yeah, good suggestion. Basically, everything which has been set underneath the automata contribution release, and every question which was asked, I've implemented so far. So I will take that home and think about it. this feature, for example, like the fade direction outputs, like the are we going in or are we going out, so you don't have the calculation with this fader. It just gives it passes this information via a string. Let's see that that's working. Next, tick going in.
Is there a way to know where you are coming from, or which state you are coming from?
Good point. Do you need that? In any case? I can't think of the case like right now. I mean, you can always like have several get state nodes and like ask for the previous state. To some extent, the get state is spreadable.
Yeah, maybe.
So you can walk around a little bit, yeah. But
obviously,
yeah, it's in
all the states around. It seems the automata UI.
I mean, yeah, there are several ways around it. You can keep track yourself,
exactly.
Or.
So I was just thinking maybe it would be useful.
Yeah.
In that mode.
Let's make a text file and I just write all these things down because I might forget them. So let's see. What was that? Dynamic transition times. That's about it. What get state does usually before a get state, or when you were using the old automata node, you usually had this kind of comparison, like bool, like asking for the string of the automata. Does basically the same, just in a more convenient way. One feature which was asked was is the state machine spreadable? Yes, it is. I've just implemented in that version a user interface for that. For example, if you spread any of the input pins, like previous or next, let's do that with a simple select. You can have several state machines based on the same structure, but they can all run in different states, basically. And now it gets really crazy. When you work with a spreaded automata, you can have a spreaded get state. Have fun with it. I don't know, I never used it, but maybe you can, I don't know. In terms of the UI, for example, let's say let's trigger any of these. Oh no, I can't show it by the UI. Basically, the buttons up here allow you to switch between all the 39 state machines I have now, and I can set each state machine to whatever, something else. So this would be maybe for convenient if you do like little modules, like for when you have like, for example, a game enemy, and this game enemy has different states, like it's living, it's running, it has fear, it runs away. You can give this little entity a state machine and you can actually spread it. So that would be a use case maybe. All right, let's go into my best practice, how I use a state machine in general. Let's reset all this stuff. Copy paste it. You can just copy paste the node and you take the tree with the node.
Mm-hmm. So keep the structure and the saving saving as different state.
You mean basically like that. You have this state machine, and if you're happy with it and you want to use it in another patch.
Yeah.
Just like if you have another patch, you just copy paste it and it takes everything with it. Basically, the whole data of the automata node is basically saved in the patch. So I was thinking about saving the structure externally by file, but I think this is kind of convenient. You don't really have to think about saving and loading and stuff.
The first pin, the input pin of the automata UI,
mm-hmm.
What does that mean? Proceed to the desktop state.
Forgot about this. I forgot all about the important features as well. Like the, you probably found that as yourself. The most important feature is of course the YOREC mode. So if you don't like color, you can use that. Reset to default pin. That is basically some sort of override. You can basically set up. You've got an enum. It's basically this one. It's hidden. You can activate it here. Default state. And you can set up like say my default state is always like my state, or let's say do something else, charge one, and you can sort of like pick any state and it's some sort of override to always to go to that state. And it's switchable. It's basically some sort of last resort. If you don't, it's often used for these kind of cases if you have in a global reset in your application. And you want to reset without transition and anything. If something goes wrong or just the timeout happened and you want to go to that state, like pausing it, that's the way to do it. Without transitions. Something else in the inspector. Focus window is again just a little convenience feature. You can sort of like connect it to a keyboard shortcut to, let's do it manually to bring the editor to the front. For the hackers of you, if anyone is into C#, basically one hint is basically you can work with this automata pin. It basically outputs the whole structure of the plugin, and you can actually access any data inside of the plugin and make your own plugin and out of the information. I was talking about Jurek the other day. Actually, Jurek tried to convince me to import Automata UI to VL for the node, but we didn't manage in terms of time. So he tried it himself, but couldn't do it because VL right now can't do Windows, extra Windows. So, but it will happen. I think we will meet in October or something, and then try it again and implement it into VL.
Because in that scenario, we also interested in being able to dynamically instantiate. For example, we could put an automata network inside
a bucket. Of course. It's basically the idea what I was talking earlier in terms of like these game entity. When a game entity has like different states and you want to handle it with a state machine. Yeah, it's nice. it's definitely gonna happen. It's just a shame right now that VL just doesn't have any render engine or has access to any windows or anything. It's just basically plain number crunching. So that's basically stopping this kind of development right now. But yeah, maybe that brings me to VL at some point. Right now I try to avoid it, but it will come one day. Okay. You can actually try to import it, but let's see what happens when you just drag it in. I don't know. Let's go back to best practice. I tend to use, as I said before, not to put any content into the state machine. So I try always to distinguish between a what I'm showing and what is basically the essence of the application. Let's imagine we have some really, really simple application where you have like four buttons on the bottom, and each button basically starts a different screen or a different patch, like different information. That's a typical exhibit or simple touch exhibit we do, like when you have like four topics and you want to see what's inside that topic. What I usually tend to do is this kind of automata. So you have the init state, always start with the init state, and you say your state is named topic. The first transition going from init to topic I call usually loaded. And I tell you why. Basically, what's going to happen here? What's going on here? What's going to happen here in between init and topic? This is basically the time when your patch starts up and loads textures and 3D files and stuff like that. and to actually control this kind of behavior. So you can basically distinguish between, okay, is my page starting up and loading all this stuff? And once it's finished, it actually reaches the topic state. So how am I going to control that? Usually I have a frame counter. Turn it to enable, and it basically counts the frames rendered in VVV or calculated in VVV. And this is basically a simple trick. If the frame counter is, like, let's say, greater than 10 or something, is the frame counter greater than 10, then the patch, you can expect the patch has started, has loaded all textures and 3D files, and is ready to rumble. So I connect this kind of little structure usually to, where is it, loaded?
Forget.
Can, don't have to.
Converts automatically. Otherwise, if you do it like that, it will be always on.
Yeah, it doesn't matter, because you go this route only once, and then you can leave it on. It doesn't interfere with anything else. So let's give it a name so everyone can see what I'm doing here. And maybe give this loaded transition like some time to breathe. Maybe you don't have to do that, but I usually tend to do that, let's say 10 frames. To animate, and let's save this project. Simple. And let's try. Once you finish that, let's try quit the patch and start the patch, and I would expect the patch being in topic already when I started, because we're not doing anything in the patch right now. So let's make a little bit of logistics. What I need you to do is basically make four buttons at the bottom of the renderer, make them clickable. Hit test, transform, basic stuff. We need a renderer, DX11, DX9, doesn't matter. A quad. Transform. Linear squared. Different colors would be probably neat. Let's zoom in a little bit. Gonna use a mouse window, a head test, quad, position XYZ. And object hit left mouse button.
Which kind of hit test shall
we use? The quad one. Since we're using a quad to paint 2D quad. And then for convenience purposes, little switch color input to actually see if I press a button. Let's do it that way. Switch color to white. Something like that. Yeah, it's basically it. So you should have this kind of behavior. Oh, we need a mouse cursor. Let's see the mouse yet. Group. So far, so good. So in terms of patch and structure, I mean, this is basically, maybe this whole workshop today is maybe more a discussion about patch structure and project structure and best practices in that way. I personally tend to use or structure my projects more in a centralized way. So basically, I tend to make all these little building blocks, like in case for the, for example these this button construction, as stupid as possible. So I tend to put not much logic inside. I mean, there's logic inside in case of like switching colors and actually detecting which button is pressed, but it's not doing anything else right now. It's just basically like a widget, like a button widget, and it can output with basically which button is pressed. So I'm kind of a send and receive maniac. Okay, I know some people don't like that, but because I'm following this kind of centralized way, I usually build these kind of little widgets and they just send out their information in terms of, like, in this case it's like four buttons and I want to know which button is basically pressed. So I say send anything after end, so let's say buttons. And I try to handle the whole application logic in a subpatch, which is called logic. So not put any logic inside any other subpatch, but I have one subpatch doing just the logic. And to extend this kind of principle, I always have a subpatch which is called interface. And this interface, for example, contains input devices like keyboard, mouse, Kinect, Leapmotion, whatever. Any input device, any hardware connection from the patch to the outside world is usually inside interface. So it's much easier to find errors. If something doesn't work and I see, okay, oh fuck, my Kinect is not working, I go inside the interface patch. I always know it's the same place basically. Same applies to logic. If something doesn't jump from one state to another, a button doesn't work or something else, a content doesn't show up, I know the place where to look at. It's basically the logic patch. Because the stupid drawing patches can't be it, because there's no logic inside. I mean, of course, during a big project, I'm not following this principle like 200%. Of course, I have like messy patches also sometimes, like somewhere down there, three levels down. But when I start a project, I always start like to follow this kind of centralized principle.
So how would you separate this? Put the mouse in the interfaces?
Yeah, well, in case the mouse is like multi-purpose, so I can, it's fine to use the mouse several times. But it all mainly in terms of like interfaces, it applies to like special hardware, like Leap, Kinect, DMX devices, stuff like that. I would put that in the special interface part, because in my experience, if something goes wrong, it's usually has something to do with the hardware. And so I put that in a very special place to find it very easily. Okay, let's go back to our centralized logic. So we are sending the buttons globally, so we can access them in the automata, in the logic patch. We could actually, there's no point grouping it right now, I think. It's not so complicated. Oh well, let's group that. I select all the stuff up here, including frame counter and stuff, and say control G and group the whole thing and call this logic. So what do I mean with not putting any content into the state machine? I mean, there are some cases it's fine to do that. If all your contents or states are very different from each other, maybe it makes sense to put content or the scene names actually into the state machine. But for example, in this case, you have like four buttons and like pretty similar actions happening. For me, it would make sense to put each of the buttons as a separate state into the state machine. What actually just happens is basically when I press the button, I switch basically the topic. So that is maybe something I can display in the state machine. So let's say a second state is named switch topic. And going from topic to switch topic, let's say the transition is called do, and we give it a duration of 120 frames. Let's make it like a bit of time for a transition. And we create a return transition from switch topic to topic back, which is called done. And we give it a duration of whatever, 20. So I guess you see the idea basically when we press a button and we want to switch basically the scene or the topic. What we do is basically you press a button and you do thing. I've done two transitions basically to say like the in fade time is like 120 frames and the out fade time is like 20 frames, so you can make like different speeds for the fade later on. To make the return transition, the done transition, once we've switched the topic and we want to automatically return to topic, what you can do is just set done as a toggle to on. So it automatically gets triggered. Once you reached a switch topic, it automatically returns to topic. Of course, you can do what I'm doing here right now with like these simple states. Of course, you can do that without a state machine. There's no question about it. But always imagine you're not just doing this kind of simple thing where like with four buttons you have like your application is a lot more complex than that, and you have to distinguish between more than this one menu you have here. So it perfectly makes sense to start with this kind of principle.
So I can lock the switch topic for a certain time and then the done will be sent back?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, right now it's like 120 frames going there and then directly going back. But you could say like make this lock for a certain amount of time and then go back.
Locking feature
dynamic as well. Yeah, probably makes sense.
There's some asynchronous process happening in switch topic.
But to some extent, if you allow these, I mean, in terms of like timings, I do understand this, but in terms of locking, this might introduce some bugs to some extent. Something you don't see actually. I mean, I could add the locking time to the name to make it a little bit more visible. But in terms of the more you control out from the outside of the state machine, the more problems you probably create. So yeah, of course, I do understand the need. So and I'm just saying, when you work with this kind of feature, if it's there, just making you aware this might introduce bugs.
How many tiers of asynchronous is better to split the state into a different state?
So once you load it or get the result, you pass it
into another state machine. Into another state machine.
Or another state.
Just another state. Yeah, of course.
Alright, so we have an automatic transition here, and we have a pretty much automatic transition here, and now let's do the do transition actually when pressing one of these buttons. As I said, we have a central logic, so we don't manage which of these buttons is actually pressed, so they get the index at the button side. We do it in the logic patch. So I receive the buttons at this place. Use Vuxen's multi flip flop animation advanced. This one. So this basically gives me the index of which button was pressed, and whenever any button was pressed, so we have a change, we trigger the do transition. So let's try that out. And if you now press your buttons, the state machine should already run in terms of timing and do the switch topic thing. Is this working for you? So, the next thing would be, I only want to present this kind of index I'm creating here, so basically which button was pressed, no? Index 1, index 0, index 2, index 3, only at the point in time when I reach switch topic. To basically have the ability to animate or like fade out the previous topic, and only when I reach switch topic, then I basically switch the topic. So you can do that in a simple way with the get state node. I have to make a pack, it's not convenient dragging dropping this stuff in. Get state node, I ask for, if I want to sample and hold this index when I reached switch topics. That's why I'm asking here for switch topic. And do a little simple and hold. So once I reach that state, let's save that index. And when you try it out, it should be in sync with your state machine. Okay, that's pretty much the logic. We need basically to switch between four different scenes controlled by four buttons. The rest is actually just displaying the scenes, or like I'm doing like a simple example with some text and connecting the fade time basically to the drawing of the text. So in order to do that, I need two information out of my logic patch. I need the index, of course, to know which topic I'm actually triggering. So let's say send index. Is there anyone here who doesn't like send and receive? I mean, it's quite kind of a critical topic. I mean, that's fine. You need the send node of the type node to actually send the automata data around your project. And conveniently, you should name this send automata, of course. And we're done. So you don't have to group that. I'm doing just doing it for clearness purposes. So I'm grouping this one and say these are my buttons. The button widget, and let's do some simple drawing. You can do quads. You can make your own sub pitches controlling by that kind of logic. I'm just doing like a little text box switching between texts now, and fading in and out. Okay, let's make a text. Let's make a string IO box, spread it with four different strings, because I'm going to switch between these texts now. And let's type in some text, node 17 rocks. The next big thing. VL or VVVV. Timeliner. Whatever. So the idea is basically I get slice any of these texts. Like imagine these are like different scenes controlled by the index. And in terms of the fading, you remember I've implemented some fade time into the state machine. Maybe someone of you can help me how to implement that into that little example. I want to not just to switch the text, but to have it fade in, fade out. What do I need?
Receiver node,
automator. What else? Get state, of course. Which and now I have to set up the get state node. Which state I have to ask for to get the proper fading? Oh, let's try topic. Connect fade in, fade out to it. Done. Of course.
In case, for example, each of the buttons brings up another patch, another program, but takes a while to load, for example, like in our synchronous. At that point, we could, instead of overwriting to one, always the done button, we could just create a new.
Yeah, you can control it on your own, basically. You can send
back to the topic.
Exactly. You can control the done thing yourself and say like, okay, no, I'm not done yet. I'm waiting for something to happen and then trigger it myself. Yeah, sure.
No, just a layer.
I mean, this is like really basic example with the text. Okay, you can make your own. Like, you can make four sub patches and ask for the index. Are we in index 0? Then fade in. Are we in index 1? Fade in. Whatever.
Is it possible that it will happen like simultaneous things?
Like have a state machine with two states? No. It's not the idea of a state machine. It's very strict. Well, in this case, this one is going to be very strict. You don't have, because
you can spread it, so you can feed them exactly the same input, but at a certain point they might behave differently, so they change behaviors. So you've got
Yeah, exactly. There's a way to emulate that. Sprouted feature.
Sender, you have to go to the logic.
Mm-hmm. But in terms like if you have a single state machine and you would allow to have this state machine can be in multiple states, then I think it would defeat the purpose of the state machine.
Yeah. This one is the
standard. Mm-hmm. Okay, this is a graph with many
nodes.
Just a
representation
of the possibility of a single entity. You know? So when you're splitting, you're becoming
two different. It's a string.
String. Also, a sand string, yeah. It's called it automatic.
It's also like
an
automatic.
Active or there is no three.
It's either there or not. Yeah, of course. It's really to control all your logic or your drawing. Usually your software is only in one state. It can't be. Can't think of
you. Quantum mechanics.
Yeah. No, it's not that advanced. So, no, it should basically work like that. I mean, it can show you like you don't have to patch that. Just showing you a different example. Let's add another. Whatever quad. And I want this quad only appear when I press the third button, so I'm asking for index, for the index, this index equals 2. And let's reuse this kind of construction, ask for state topic, and let's fade in and fade out. Maybe turning it on and off is maybe not a good idea. But you get the idea. Basically, you can have separate. That's basically a very, very simple example of a state machine having just two states switching between each other and not putting any content inside. Any questions to that? Christoph?
Can I set the default view of the automatic UI?
The default?
If you make some lot of states and the graph becomes bigger.
And you want to jump to the initial position? Or jump to
Reset the view of the.
Ah, no. Okay. My text editor?
Maybe double right.
Yeah, or just key command or something. Yeah. I've got another example prepared, which is more or less like ready-made. I think you've seen that at the keynote. But this example is in the Spielfolder, Workshop, Spiel, and just start up the root patch. So what do we have here? It's just basically a very, very simple game. Consists of a start screen. It has a game mode where you actually just can destroy quads and count. It doesn't have any trump textures inside because I'm not. I don't want to distract you, so I kept it simple. And you have a winning screen at the end. Sorry, it's German, which basically just shows the high score. So pretty prime example for using a state machine for this kind of sequential behavior. This would be an example where you actually put content or scene names into the state machine. You're just switching between different things, same things. You have like actually three different things which are going to happen sequentially, and this is gonna something we're going to implement into the state machine right now.
Which file do you
open? It's in the workshop Spiel.
Okay, I have a render.tty open here.
Maybe lawyer can help you.
I'll just close it.
Anyone else has problems not seeing the patch?
Yeah. This is using 4K, I guess.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, it's down on the right bottom.
Okay. Sorry about that. Let's remove the toggle buttons because they are just for demonstration purposes. The behavior, if this screen is actually active or not, is going to be managed inside these patches later on. Let's turn them off for now. And let's get in a state machine. From video player is probably the best. So let's say we have a start state. We have a game state, and we have a high score state, and that's basically about it. And going from the init to the start state, we do like the standard construction, like we want to wait for loading textures and 3D files and stuff like that. So let's call this transition again loaded. Get your frame counter. It's bigger than 10. And done. So in terms going from the start state to the actual game, I would propose we just use a simple mouse click to actually, you know, start the game. So there's not much to choose from. You could follow the concept that you send the event of like clicking from the patch itself. So like, let's say the intro patch is actually displaying the start game text. You could say like you send the event from there, but for simplicity purposes, I would say, nah, we don't need that send, it's stupid. Let's do that directly in the logic patch. Let's make this a little bit bigger. Let's say call this whatever click or go to start go to game. In terms of naming convention for states and transitions, I'm still not really sure what to use. Sometimes I use go to. Sometimes I use the word for the actual action in terms of like click, but I'm not sure. I'm open for any recommendation. In terms of best practice, okay, we have go to game. Let's get a mouse. Window, and we just connect the pin go to game with the left mouse button and talk edge. Something like that. Zooming in. So from my experience in terms of like best practice, using states to actually control the behavior of the software makes creates basically less bugs or makes your software more reliable. And one little thing is actually making your software more reliable as well when you actually give transitions a certain time. You're not using just transitions for transition timings for like fadings, but it actually makes sure that you actually moved from one state to another. For example, like when you have in a mouse clicking in the start state and a mouse clicking in the game state, and you just directly connect it like I did here, it might happen that you go too fast from one state to another, and it gets more secure and more reliable if you give your transitions actually a little bit of time to move from one state to another. So what I usually do is like at least give it one frame or like two frames time. In this case, because we're using the transition again for fading, give it a lot more time. But if you don't use it for fading, consider giving it a little bit more time, because usually switching from one state to another, like two frames or three frames, is not much. It's just makes your software a little bit more secure. So let's say we go again with 60 frames for the transition, because we want to use the fade again. And I go into the intro patch now and connect the intro patch, like you remember the start game patch, with my automator node. And in order to do that, of course, I have to send the automator node. Send node automata. You see it starts to repeat best practice. Then just get the get state node. The receiver, ask for the state start, and connect the fade in out with alpha of the text. So since I'm on DX11 to see alpha, actually I have to add a blend mode node. Who's using DX11 here? And the rest DX9? Okay. So this blend node is only for the DX11 guys. You probably know that. Stupid me. No, I'm DX9. Sorry.
Yeah.
Well, I think I've repatched that in DX11, like, but yeah, sorry. some confusion. I'm not the morning guy. I'm more. My brain is more working after 12 o'clock. Could actually test the stuff already. Remember, pressing control and left click onto a state or a transition actually triggers the state, so you can I can go to start and just click with the mouse into the game screen. I see the transition going from start to game. I could actually trigger this this way as well, like by pressing control onto go to game, I would see that transition as well. Over and over. So that comes, that's quite a handy feature. Okay, next we can go from start to game. Let's care about the game patch. There's a little bit more to do inside the game patch. Basically, first of all, we have of course to enable the game patch according to the state machine. So once we are in the game mode, we want to display the game. So what you could do is just control the enabled pin, or you can do a fade by controlling the alpha of all the layers. I keep it simple and use the enabled pin to just enable the group to display the game. So let's say receive node automata get date it's not showing up here. Always have to drag and drop it in. Sometimes it VVV just recognizes plugins which have already been used, and in my case it's just have to drag and drop it in. Stupid. Okay, let's ask for game and use the state active pin to actually activate the group. Let's simulate this. We are on start. I press bam, the game. Start, press button, bam, game. So depending if we are going into the game mode, it would be nice to actually reset some things. So we have to reset the counter, the game counter, once we are going into the game mode, and we have to reset the timeout. Basically, the game only runs for 20 seconds, and we have to reset this kind of time. So that's pretty easy. Let's copy the receiver automata node and get state, and let's look up here. We've got a reset for the time. I'm zooming in. So this should be pretty easy. Just ask for the game mode here and use a toc edge with state active out to actually reset something once you are going into the state. Yeah, exactly. You could reset it and when you are in the start screen, doesn't really matter.
But if you you want to fade in.
If you fade and you want, you have to choose a different point in time, of course, yeah, for the reset. It's probably better than to reset the game counter and the time before you fade in.
Yeah, I mean, the fade in is bigger than zero.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Connect to the state active.
If anyone has questions or something, just ask. If I'm too fast, then. Or I forget to mention any of something. Okay, we're resetting the time and now we're doing the same with the points, which is down here. It's just a simple counter counting up the hits, so we can just connect this reset with the reset up there, or just do another receive automator get state, whatever. I just didn't connect all this stuff to that, just to show you where it's like, where are the little bits basically to which you have to care about, which are basically state machine dependent. So let's try that. Simulated control press start to go back. Game runs. Okay, and after 20 seconds it just stops and gives us the information that the game is over. We're just not yet giving this information to the state machine. It will be the next step. I'm almost not thinking about it anymore, but I find this kind of workflow, like while you are building your scene flow, basically using the state machine all the time, like for example to go back in time and then basically go through all the steps of your software, of your game, for example, I find it really convenient. Like you always have to, it's really easy to jump between all the stuff and check if this is basically what I'm expecting here. So I usually have this automator window always open on the top left corner of my screen and switch patches all the time. Okay, next one. Actually, the game itself is outputting the end of the game here with a send. So we already get this information at this point in time. So we just have to connect this send to our state machine. But in order to do that, of course, we need another transition because we need to go from game to high score. So let's do that. Do high score. Oops. Spelling mistake. Again, let's give it a time, like 60 frames.
Change the name of the.
Oops, yeah, I've done that before. Yeah, stupid me. 60 frames. Okay, and just connect. Go to high score with game end. Unfortunately, I used the German word for it, Spielende. So just create a receiver of type value, and you can pick either the first one Punkte is points and Spielende is game end. So use Spielende, and I can't connect here because typical issue with a state machine, at some point you run into that you have to use a frame delay. So now in terms of like best practice, where to put the frame delay. What I usually tend to do is not put the frame delay at this point of patch, but this is basically, you could argue with that. You could use all your frame delays for loops in terms of state machine at this place. You could put all the frame delays into the logic patch. I usually do it where I send the information. But this is like really a matter of taste.
Like, yeah, frame delay in the state. So.
But I don't find any arguments why you do it here or here. It's really a matter of taste, I guess. So let's put a frame delay in between here. It's just basically a matter where you're using the frame delay that you always do it the same way. So you find the little buggers, and if something goes wrong, you know, okay, I've put the frame delay at this place and not this place. Actually, a few days ago, I was messing with the state machine and. This happens as well, like you can get these like evil frame delay loops where you start to spread your state machine, and this will definitely crash your patch. So it's still a slippery slope to some extent. Okay, frame delay is there, Spielende is connected to go to high score. Let's try that. Start game. Play game. I should make the game a little bit shorter, I guess. 20 seconds. And I'm in high score, but I'm not displaying anything yet. So it should be easy. Go inside high score and receive node again, automata, get state, ask for high score, connect with enabled, and done. Yeah, yeah, you're right. Exactly, typical scenario for like using a state machine to actually disable certain functionality. That's true. So let's say here at mouse hit, I could also ask for this and say, and fix that. Going from, I guess you have managed to reach that point. Going from the high score screen back to the start screen, you have maybe two ways to do that. I'm going to try one experiment now. I've never tried this before, but I guess it's working. Let's say we want to go from the high score after a certain time back to the start screen. You could maybe say high score is locked for a certain time, let's say again like 60 seconds, not one second, let's say 120 frames means 2 seconds, the high score state is locked, so we are going to stay there at least for 2 seconds, and now we do a new transition going from high score back to start. To start. Give this again a time of whatever, 30 frames. And just enable this transition forever. So once we reach the high score screen, but it's locked for 120 frames, and after that, to start transition is automatically triggered. Hopefully, let's try that. Let's decrease my gaming time. Start game, 5 seconds game time. I won, and back to start game. I just realized it probably makes sense to put a main loop inside the patch, because the patch is running too fast right now. It's not actually 60 frames. You have to set the frame loop, the main loop, to 60 frames to actually sync everything in the right time. But then it should actually work. Yeah, you mind displaying as a text here? Yeah, it makes sense, yeah. Or at least if a state is locked or has some lock setting, that it's at least visualized to some extent, yeah. You're definitely right. I haven't been working with locked states so much. It's pretty ignored feature, but yeah, you're definitely right. Try to avoid this kind of animation, because that would mean refreshing the UI every frame, and I was really concentrating on making this plugin as CPU friendly as possible. I mean, it's running on 40 ticks and it's basically eating up nothing, and that's basically because the UI is not updating. It just updates when I do something. Yeah. That's about it, basically, about the state machine. It's a basic workflow, the best practice. I gave you just another project. It's basically the video player I was talking earlier about, which uses a toggle transition and just tries to basically, let's open it up for a short second. But it basically follows the same principle. It has three different states, like for place, stop, and scrub. And all the stuff concerning drawing and interaction is basically dependent on this kind of state machine. So let's say we start the state machine in place. We are playing the video. And when I just click on the progress bar, the state machine states we are in the scrub state. And when I release the mouse button, I've programmed, so once I'm in scrub, and I release the mouse button, I'm always going back to stop. You could say you are always going back to play, or you could maybe do something like remember which state I'm in before and go to that state. I've used here a toggle position, basically because I can toggle with this button between play and stop. Yeah, right. And funny thing is, whatever, what I find fun, actually, you find funny, remember the patch I showed you before in the presentation, like the video player doing exactly the same thing. Like it was really messy and lots of stuff and monoflops and stuff. And this is basically the same interface just with the state machine. And when you look inside the logic, not much to it actually. When we look into the playback, there's pretty much just the file stream player inside and just receiving and sending halt information. No logic inside. When we go into the interface, it's really just quads sending the scrub value of the progress bar. It's another quad file texture, bit of mouse and hit test. That's it. So that's basically a prime example of where a state machine actually really helps, like get used like really few nodes for the same problem. I was surprised myself actually. I just did this video player for the workshop to check out if this is actually helping with the video player, and I was surprised myself. Okay. It's very little nodes. Questions? I mean, I've got some wishes from you. I'm quite happy about that. So, something to work on. And, yeah. I'm not sure, I don't have anything to say.
When we make a transition, there's a duration for the transition. Actually, if you want to add some animations during this time, what you recommend to port the animation logic?
How to control the animation logic? I'm not getting the question.
There's a state one, I want to go to state two.
Yeah.
There's a transition time. During the transition time, where I want to do something like a fade or color changing, something like that.
You have countless possibilities what you do with this kind of value change from 0 to 1. You can use the tweener node, for example, to make it like to convert this kind of simple animation to like a tweened animation. If you want to change the values, you can use a map node. You are not limited to 0 to 1, or you can even control the torus light timeliner at some point.
Okay.
Or the old timeliner, because the old timeliner has a time input, and you could actually scrub with the fade output, the timeliner. So it's basically this fade output is like really, really multi-purpose. You can use a really, really old school trick like input morph.
Okay.
Yeah, exactly.
Then if you evaluate or enable everything, then maybe the slower VDD itself.
Yeah.
So when I'm using the switching such thing, I'm using the evaluate thing of the module to do nothing. But at the moment, some kind of trouble with the frame issue. So what is the best practice for yourself to using with big machines, multiple big machines?
Pretty much. I mean, the automata get state. Is the state active or not? Can you also like enable and disable the evaluate pin? And but if you have to, we usually have to do this and more like patching around that, because usually you want to enable first or evaluate and then fade in. So we have to do some tricks on that. And I'm not having any best practice on that. I'm not using this kind of principle that often. Not having much projects where I have to use evaluate or the stuff like that. Usually when I have this kind of stuff running, like I switch to C# and do something there to save power and have more like an event-based system. Oh, one thing I forgot about to mention, one note I just did a few days ago, which might come handy at some point. Imagine you have some exhibit which runs like on its own or travels around the world, and you want to get some statistics about the exhibit, about the usage, how often are using, or how often are people choosing a certain topic, or is it actually used at all, stuff like that. There's a node called logging. So you drag drop automata inside and choose logging. And you just connect it to your central state machine and say file name, and just start to save it on the desktop. Whatever. Let's give it a proper name. Logging.txt. So every time your state machine changes, it just keeps track of the changes. Just saves basically the date, the time, the state name, and you have the ability to enter a custom message here. So to save more additional information with that state change for your logging, which might come handy. I think Daniel from Meso just showed me a website which I didn't know about, which is called Grafana. Which I'm going to look into, to basically import the logging file, the time-based logging file, into Grafana to have like really nice statistics of the usage of your exhibit or your VVV application based on the state changes of your automata. Because it's quite interesting, like, because it's the automata, the state machine, is like the central point in my patches, so it knows everything about the global changes, so it's the best place to lock the project. Not sure if this is useful for you, but it's an interesting aspect, I guess. The logging node, it's again just drag and drop the automata UI DLL into the patch, and then you get a list of three nodes. And of course, logging is async, so it doesn't interrupt anything, or just doesn't cost you anything. So if your customer asks for, can we lock your exhibit or your VVV patch, and you can just say, yes, we can. You said you just charged 2,000 euros and you just drag drop the logging node inside. Huh, Christoph?
Yeah, just asked about that 2 days ago from the client.
Hey. So you know the price tag now.
Yeah. I raised it even more.
All right. Thank you for your attention. If you have any questions during the day, I'm here to 7 o'clock p.m. and just ask and talk to me, whatever.
Thank you.
Thank you.